In this video, I'm interviewing Dr. Roman Gerber from Wink Family Eye Care on what it takes to stop myopia, what causes nearsightedness, and how to prevent myopia from getting worse. So let's take a look. Hey guys, welcome. This is Dr. Joe Allen here from Dr. Eye Health, and I'm here today with Dr. Roman Gerber from Wink Family Eye Care, premier eye clinics located in Chanhassen and St. Louis Park, Minnesota. And we're gonna be talking about nearsightedness and myopia control. And hey, at any point throughout the video, check out the show notes and links below for further information about everything that we mentioned, as well as some extra links so that you can get in contact with Dr. Gerber at Wink Family Eye Care. All right, so Dr. Gerber at Wink Family Eye Care, you guys focus a lot on myopia progression and what's called myopia control. And hey, if you have not heard of the term myopia, that's the medical term for nearsightedness. But really, why do you think, Dr. Gerber, it's myopia progression is becoming such a problem? Why do we need to be concerned about it?
So, great question. Oftentimes kids will start off and they'll be slightly myopic or nearsighted. They'll start by being around a minus one. And what that means for them is that they can function really well throughout the day, but the board is pretty fuzzy and they need their glasses and or contacts to see the board clearly. Later on, they will start getting more and more nearsighted, where they will be about a minus three, minus five, or a minus eight. And at those levels, it becomes harder to function. They can't see their alarm clock. They can't move around a room clearly without having glasses or contacts. So they become much more reliant and it becomes harder for them to see. Now, disease-wise, as they get more nearsighted, their eye will actually grow and get longer. Mm-hmm. And so it increases their chance of developing a retinal detachment. In one study, it found that patients who were a minus eight, as compared to somebody who had no prescription, were over 20 times more likely to develop a retinal detachment, which can lead to blindness. For a condition like myopic maculopathy, it's almost 125 times more likely that they could develop that condition as compared to somebody who doesn't have any nearsightedness. So disease-wise, it's also an area that makes us at Wink Family Eye Care very concerned.
So I totally agree. I think across the board, eye care professionals, we want to prevent eye disease, prevent blindness. Certainly those major conditions, like you mentioned, maybe glaucoma, things like cataracts, retinal detachments, and then that macular maculopathy is a major concern. And so, yeah, I think if we can do anything to prevent nearsightedness from getting worse, you know, if someone just starts at a minus two, if we can keep that to a minus two, minus three, rather than let that excel to a minus eight, that's going to be a big win. Yeah. So obviously here as eye care professionals, we want to stop myopia. And if you're somebody who's really concerned about the myopic epidemic or myopia epidemic, then please go ahead and comment in the section below, stop myopia. Go ahead and shout that out for us, okay? All right, so well, if you don't mind, Dr. Gerber, let's go over a little bit more of what causes nearsightedness. Could you shed some light on that?
Yeah, so there's this constant nature versus nurture debate, and like most answers to that debate, this one, the answer is both. There's usually a genetic component. We find that kids who have parents who are nearsighted are much more likely to develop nearsightedness themselves. Similarly, we have seen a doubling in the increase in myopia due to tablets, due to phones, and this has just been over the past 20 years. So that has not been a genetic change, but has rather been a more nurture change. When we go abroad, when I do charity clinics myself, I go to places sometimes where education ends in second or third grade. And if that happens, those kids do not develop nearsightedness in the same way that kids in the United States do. So it's definitely kind of both there.
Wow, so I completely agree. I know we see a lot more kids nowadays on things like tablets and phones. Certainly it's great that they're doing stuff for school, but Absolutely. That extra time up close has been proven to kind of push people to become more nearsighted earlier on and develop those higher rates of myopia. So yeah, when it comes to clinic, I know we have a lot of different tools available to us. Certainly we have glasses, we have contact lenses we can prescribe to help kids see better. And then even as we get older, there's options like LASIK too. But what about helping prevent myopia from getting worse? What can we do to what are some of the tools and theories that we can apply as an eye doctor to really help our patients? Well, what do you think?
So I think it is very important that we do do something. For the longest time, parents have asked us what they can do to slow down progression or stop myopia, and we haven't had great tools. Over 30 years ago, we used to use line bifocals and put kids in those, and that appeared to help, but only a minimal amount, so that has definitely fallen out of favor. The two things I find are the most beneficial are orthokeratology and soft multifocal contacts. And orthokeratology,
In case you guys don't know, orthokeratology, it sounds like a fancy term, but really it's a special type of contact lens that helps fit on the eye. And why don't you go over a little bit more about what orthokeratology is?
Yeah, so it's a really cool contact. It's a large, hard contact that is usually very comfortable, that is only worn at night nowadays. So what happens is the cornea has the contact over it, and then it gets flattened by this contact that using orthokeratology, and then the child wakes up, takes the contact out, and they can see clearly. They don't wear glasses, they don't wear contacts, and they can see the world very clearly. It does what LASIK does, but only temporarily and safely in children.
So it's like kind of the opposite of wearing contact lenses during the day to see. It's actually a contact lens that you wear at nighttime.
Yeah.
You sleep with it. It's safe to sleep in, but it actually morphs and sculpts, kind of molds the front surface of the eye so that during the day you can see clearly. And then again, you kind of just repeat it every night. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is absolutely correct.
Excellent. And so that actually slows down the slows down the development of nearsightedness?
Yeah, so a completely different mechanism is working on slowing down the progression of nearsightedness using what appears to be hyperopic defocus. Appears to be the best theory that explains it, but the eye doesn't elongate. It actually has a dampening effect on the elongation. Most studies show very large ranges, but I think probably 50 to 80% slowdown in progression using orthokeratology.
So that's a great benefit, right? If you could slow down a child's progression by 50 to 80% with those types of lenses, I mean, that's significant, right?
Yeah, so absolutely.
And especially for someone that could just wear the lenses at nighttime, that's a pretty simple solution.
Yeah.
Now, just a quick thing on orthokeratology, who's the best candidate for that type of instrument or that type of really prescription? Who's going to benefit the most from that?
So it's usually kids because it can slow down the progression, but it can be used in adults just for vision correction as well.
Perfect.
It can be low myopes, kids who have about a minus one, or even higher myopes in the minus three, minus four, minus five range, and they can do really well. It also does great for those of us with dry eye because you don't wear a contact throughout the day. Nothing gets drier as the day continues.
That's an excellent point. I didn't even think about that for dry eyes. But now, beyond just the ortho-K, those type of contact lenses, now soft multifocals, I've heard a lot about that as being another solution. Can you talk about those?
Yeah, so soft multifocals were originally invented for those of us over 40, when it became hard for us to see our phones and we wanted to wear contacts so we could see our phones and look further away.
Yep.
So, but they also found that soft multifocals have the same hyperopic defocus kind of progression, and it stops the eye from getting longer. So that helps the eye out, and you don't get the progression that you do kind of with regular contacts, with regular glasses. Again, similar, about 50 to 80%.
So the focusing mechanisms of these contact lenses still give you good vision for the person wearing them, for maybe your child, a family member, but it actually helps, it has this little defocus mechanism in theory that helps prevent that eye from elongating and making nearsightedness worse. So that's really fascinating. Is it, so we really just have the contact lenses, or are there other options?
There are other options as well. Atropine has been used for at least 20, 30 years or so. Atropine is a dilating drop, and we all know how much patients love dilating. But at full strength, it dilates the eye for up to a week or more, and then patients would use this, and it did seem to slow down progression pretty well. The problem was you'd be dilated, so you couldn't see up close, and you'd be sensitive to light.
Right.
So there's actually a study that came out a few years ago called the ATOM 2 study that seemed to show that lower concentrations of atropine were still protective for myopia, which was wonderful. So you don't have the same dilation and loss of focusing power up close, and it seems much better there. I primarily use it as an adjunct therapy, okay, in combination with contact lenses.
Excellent. So I completely agree. I know about all those different applications and tools, but I know that I don't think atropine isn't as common, is it? I think the contact lenses are a little bit more readily available. More practitioners are probably utilizing that. Would you agree?
From what I have seen, absolutely. What's great about the contacts is they fix the vision as well.
Yeah.
So the child can walk around and they can see clearly. Atropine would be used in combination with either contacts or glasses,
okay,
and so it's an extra drop.
Excellent. Yeah. So what about children who don't want to wear contact lenses or use drops? Is there even just kind of things, lifestyle changes or different glasses or something else that would be a good modification for as an option for those people?
Yeah, great question. So what they could do is they could decrease screen time, and particularly screen time up close.
Okay.
That appears to be the big factor that causes these big jumps in myopia. So if your kid is on a handheld device, make them watch TV. do small improvements.
Yeah, easier said than done.
Yeah.
Right? I know a lot of times it's like, we don't want children to stop doing their studies. We want them to keep performing well in school, so they got to finish their homework, right? It's good for them to read. But a lot of times, I know for myself, when I was growing up, I spent a lot of time playing video games, you know, handheld, like Game Boy stuff, right up close. And I think that's great. It's great for the kids to play and have fun, but perhaps just recommending or seeing if they could spend more time maybe playing games or hanging out with their friends outside and a little bit less time spent all day inside stuck on a screen.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Mm-hmm.
So eye health question of the day. Have you heard of any of these different methods for myopia control? Which one is your favorite? And do you have any other questions about them? Go ahead and comment in the section below. Let us know what your questions are. All right, so question round. We're doing some quick questions here with Dr. Gerber to get to know him a little bit better. So first, tell us favorite movie.
Terminator 1 and 2.
Oh my God, okay. Not 3 or 4 or 5 or not.
No, not 3, 4, 5.
Yay, Arnold. Okay, cats or dogs?
Dogs. I have a dog named Winnie.
Named Winnie. What kind of dog?
She's a Havanese, 9.5 pounds. She's wonderful.
I have no idea what a Havanese is.
Google her.
I'll have to look that up. Coffee or tea?
Tea.
Tea. Okay, yes, yeah. What kind of tea?
I like herbal tea.
Oh, herbal stuff. See, I'm a green tea guy. Yeah. I can't do coffee. Favorite sport?
Tennis.
What about your favorite pastime?
So what I love doing more than anything is surfing. I live in
Minnesota. Yeah.
No, I don't. I live in Minnesota and I can barely surf, but if I could do anything, I would surf.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Favorite color?
Dr. Sarah would kill me if I didn't say green. Okay. So green.
Yep. Green. Yeah. Here in the clinic, all green.
Yeah.
Favorite food?
Spinach and kale, because it's high in lutein and zeaxanthin and good for your eyes.
Oh my God. Totally eye doctor.
Yes.
Here. Glasses, contacts.
Contacts.
Okay, awesome. What for?
Myopia control.
Oh, yes. Myopia control. All right. All right, guys. Thanks so much for watching. Make sure to go ahead and like, subscribe, and share this video with any friends and family. Want to say a quick thank you to Dr. Gerber for having me here.
Thank you so much for coming here, and thanks for letting me be part of this.
Of course. And so, otherwise, keep an eye on it. We'll talk to you soon.